a real-life interactive demo of taking a user into an application container and playing with it as he usually plays with his desktop. So currently, in the meantime, many of the advances have been on the application layer. And that's basically my talk. So, okay, so I'm Wolfgang Gensch. The other, my partner, Burak Yenir, we founded UberCloud in 2012, trying to find out why engineers and scientists are a little bit behind cloud, while in the enterprise space, they were already right in the middle, really heavily using it. So the idea was we did experiments, cloud experiments, taking real engineers with their real applications onto real cloud resources. So now that community is over 4,500 companies in 72 countries. So the community of software providers who participate in the meantime is grown to, has grown to 120 active ISVs. All major names are certainly there. And on the cloud resource provider side, there are 54 who participate in that initiative. We still continue. We wanted to stop it after 50 experiments. In the meantime, we are over 200. We gain more and more insight in really the user behavior, in really the user requirements, and we learn, right? And you will see how fast the application community is pushing us forward with more and more requirements. And you heard him here. I mean, InfiniBand, MPI, RDMA, and all that stuff. This is long ago that they asked for it. And it's already implemented on the application layer for now over a year. So as you see here, we participated in the Docker's first workshop in San Francisco. And we found out that the microservices Docker container technology is a very nice starting point because of all the beautiful features you have, which the Docker community, which is huge in the meantime, has recognized to be so useful. Now we thought this might really be useful as well for the HPC community. But microservices don't help, right? So you need HPC, HPC, HPC layer. And we have built about 30 plus HPC layers on top. So all of the kinds of bells and whistles and engineers and scientists were asking. So in the meantime, there is a marketplace. It was almost by chance that we said this technology enables a level of automation, which you need when you want to go to the shopping mall, into your famous ANSYS store, for example, look for 24 hours, 32 cores, fluent, ANSYS fluent, for $299, paying by credit card or by invoice, and then getting a welcome email with the link and the login information, and you click on the link and you're immediately in your application container. So you see Fluent, the software, already pre-packaged, pre-configured for the specific environment it is sitting on, and the end user can immediately start to basically upload their data. There are instructions there how to do that in different ways, and then start the application and run and do interactive stuff even. And it really looks like his or her own desktop. One of the real requirements of the engineers 3 years ago was, I don't want to learn anything new. I have so many things already on my plate. So I don't want to learn a new platform, some new knobs, some new icons and whatever. There is too much I have already on my plate. So finally, in September, okay, so that, yeah, UberCloud overview, that's that one. I skip a few slides, but these slides are available. And I'm really more now showing the application side. Right, we have heard very nice, deep information about the system and the developer side. So that this is now really the other side of the spectrum, right? So, okay, so what do we have here? I skipped that because, I mean, for the application side, this is quite important, because containers really enable easy access, not only what we have seen to the laptop. So what Christian is developing on the laptop side, now with these containers, especially with the application containers, are seamlessly running on nodes of clusters, so on clusters with many nodes, and also in clouds. So there is no difference anymore to move applications and data back and forth. So, and that's about the market. There are a lot of market drivers these days, which make it very clear that HPC basically, it can't be avoided that HPC successively follows the bigger trend of the applications in enterprises. So the microservices, very often web application-based applications, and the macro services, the HPC applications, they are currently following this trend. So we see really an uptake just in the last 12 months. And these are all, you know, the drivers which are sitting on the and pushing the whole thing. Okay, so I want to skip that one. And after about 50 experiments, that was about 6 months later, in 2013, we put a long list of 13 roadblocks together. I have that list a little bit later. And we will see what containers can do, HPC containers, based on Docker. You know, the lowest layer is always Docker. And when Docker is coming out with the next release, we just move the old layer out and push the latest new release layer underneath. So the challenges to move to the HPC cloud, this is manifold. So everybody has his concerns. Right? So there is So there is the end user, which still is reluctant for a couple of reasons. I don't want to go into detail, but you know, it's security, it's losing control, it's heavy data traffic, it's licensing, and so on. And I mean, it sounds somewhat not really humble, I would say, but with the containers, you can at least reduce drastically or even remove all these roadblocks. Okay, so I mean, you read yourself. We had a panel yesterday where we discussed with software providers how the new licensing could potentially disrupt the ISV's traditional business. And we found out, so the answer of the ISV was, in the beginning, yes, they were very concerned, but in the meantime, they have tested different license models and found, you know, add-on, more flexible license model, like ANSYS really came up, just announced their elastic licensing, and other ISVs like COMSOL, they have their network licensing, which includes cloud. Kind of, they say that is a network. So if you have the network license, you are allowed to, for no additional cost, then to go into the cloud. So in the meantime, most ISVs have already implemented one or the other way of additional licensing, more dynamic, flexible licensing. Right? So the problem, again, when you are working in the HPC application market, so when you look at the IDC numbers, these are 16 different verticals. And this is, in the beginning, 4 years ago, there was no united community around HPC in the cloud. Because every vertical, they had their very different approaches, and they speak different languages. Only one language, it's the same. They speak almost the same language when it comes to the horizontal computing layer. So that's that way you can talk to them. And the cloud is part of that. Roadblocks, as I mentioned here, we have seen that, and there are real roadblocks, or there were real roadblocks 4 years ago, 3 years ago, 2 years ago, and perceived roadblocks, as we said. So we could discuss that, but we certainly have no time. But security, compliance, cost, cloud expertise, these are a lot perceived, because very often you compare apples with oranges, what I see often is that on-premise IT folks say, I paid $300,000 for that system. And that cost, they compare to 10 cents per corporate hour in the cloud. But they completely miss that on that side, the system cost is only 10% of the overall total cost over 3 years. Right? So these kind of things, we have some papers on our website which really clearly and in detail discuss that. So there is, in my humble opinion, there is really only one solution to all these different things. And certainly, I mean, more or less, we have to continue to work on each of the single ones. But the HPC containers, they help with their packaging. I mean, so this is about packaging. It is about portability, accessibility, usability, scalability. Then there is maintainability and supportability. So maintenance and support with the containerized ISV application, where the ISV containerizes, tests it, evaluates it, and then ships it to the customer. And the customer only have to push a button and the system is up and running. So there is no installation, configuration, etc. anymore at the user side. So it is somewhat disruptive, and it will take two or three more years so that this becomes a real breakthrough, but so we will see that. Okay, so yeah, I'm basically running over these things. These things have been discussed at length. So within our 200 experiments, we have set up kind of all different roadblocks, and we have discussed them very briefly. You know, so you see here the usually the structure is. So this is the issue here, this is the recommendation, and then you know, sometimes there are some comments. So like security in the cloud is at the same standard level as any other IT environment these days. I mean, a cloud provider puts a lot of money into security, and very often, it's, especially in small and medium enterprises, the IT folks there, if there are IT folks at all, they cannot afford like these 250,000-300,000 euro guys. Okay, so data transfer. There is one thing which we have done recently. We have put nice DCV in every container. So depending on your requirements for data transfer, you can accelerate it through GPUs. So our containers are also talking to GPUs. Using nice DCV, for example, for acceleration of the data, but also for HD, high quality video quality visualization. Then there is the cloud cost. That's already, so that's the paper, slash cost, easy, which I was talking about. And you really see with the curve a crossover, which depends, among others, but mostly about your internal on-premise utilization of your own system. So if your utilization is already very high, like in many like research computer centers who run 90-95%, then that system is more affordable, so is cheaper, I would say, as a whole, with all the total cost, than in the cloud. But what you see in practice, utilization is often in the order of 20-40%. And then cloud is about 2-3 times cheaper than the overall system cost. Right? So this is discussed in that paper. Okay, software licensing. I hope I have that slide, last minute one, which I prepared for the ISV panel yesterday. We have basically resolved the issue to capture all the different ISV licensing models, which ISVs have developed over the last 2 to 3 years for the cloud, in simply putting a licensed server in each container. So we don't have to fiddle around with anything. So we look at the current license model. So there is BYOL, for example, bring your own license on the end user side. Or there is a kind of a conservative ISV, independent software vendor, who wants to maintain complete control over everything. So the license server is at their premises, or there is some flavor mix in between. And if they trust, for example, if the ISVs completely trust a cloud provider, which you see more and more, so there are like ANSYS is working very closely together already for 2 to 3 years with a handful of which they now know well, reliable cloud providers, because they have worked with them for the last 2-3 years. Then they give them basically the software and a global license key, so to speak, for all the pieces of software which are, the Ansys container on our side has 10 Ansys tools, Fluent, CFX, Mechanical, etc. And they get a kind of a golden key, so to speak, and only at the end of the month they deliver a list of users and the usage and the cost, etc. And that's it. I think I was talking about that one. Didn't remember where I really put it in. But here you see it. So based on these 200 plus experiments we have done, we have learned any flavor, you know, or every flavor of license model you can imagine. And so this is currently really the license mechanism which covers most, I would say, most of the existing license model variations for the cloud. Okay, so okay, I skipped the marketplace. That is kind of our experimentation field that gets us in close contact with the end user and see we really can explore the end user's behavior in a context to buying on demand the whole software stack, because it is about, you know, the underlying computing cluster plus the middleware plus the container with the application. So we basically we have seen that. So that's the container. Let me just advance over across. This is the list I was talking about. This list is now 3 years old, right? And about 1 year later, after we were ready with our first open foam container, we could really say, okay, we covered security. I want to really mention that, because security was a big topic also this morning at the VHPC workshop. We see in practice, and I'm really only talking about practice, right? We see in practice that end users want 8 cores. Mostly, however, 16, 32, 64, 128. So a sweet spot currently is 128 cores. Sometimes 256. Okay, so meaning these are complete instances or multiples of instances. So they are not willing and even able to share the resources which they get with anybody else. So there is no multi-tenancy on that cluster which they get, right? It is just single tenancy. So therefore, no other guy can have root access the same way, can have use the same resources, they can fight over, you know, the cache hierarchy, the memory hierarchy, using the same links, etc., blah, blah. So that is a very strong benefit, which you especially have or get from the containers, from the HPC containers in an HPC. Okay, so, and that's what it says here. So this is a dedicated server in a high secure data center, usually. I mean, the data centers today, they are really very high. Then you have disk encryption, you have OS PKI login, you have OS firewall, you have HTTP, VPN access, etc. So, many of the experiments, we used all of that, so the whole security stack in that context. And this is a real benefit of high-performance computing environments. So, the next big project we had last year after our first workshop was project together with Intel on the Lawrence Livermore National Lab Hyperion supercomputer. So we developed, until then it was just a one node, one container environment, up to 32 cores. So we pushed that up to 64 nodes, 1,024 cores. We did benchmarks, so there was a question before about benchmarks. Deviation was plus and minus, again, the same question, the same interesting observation, plus minus 0.5%. So, it's kind of this kind of architecture. You see, it's all across InfiniBand, right? So we took the same thing then to Azure, to the A8, A9 instances, with RDMA InfiniBand, and we see the same results, right? Deviations from between plus minus. I have something like that here. So overhead 0.5. This is even negative, and this is plus 0.5 difference between bare metal and containers. Right? And we have a lot of internal benchmarks. We took all the Ohio State University. So OSC. Ohio Supercomputer Environment, so the OSC. They have developed application kernels. We ran all of them on this system. It was part of the project, and all very similar results. So this is basically our Dockerized environment. So it's, that's all about the multi-container environment. We used Intel libraries and compilers for that, because Intel certainly was a great supporter of the whole thing. Networking between the containers, set up NFS, SSH, and we basically were able to take all the benefits from single node into a multi-node container environment as well. So there was no drawback, etc. So I'm almost done. And the last 9 months, because last 9 months before we had the first workshop, where I did a live demo, etc. But I thought I just summarize what we have done and achieved in the meantime. As I said, nice DCV in every container for remote desktop with HD quality, encrypted connection for data transmission. So OpenHPC, some of you might have participated in the OpenHPC BOF. So this is a new, big, growing project pushed by the HPC community. Intel is driving it partially. There are about 40 other contributors. We have developed an OpenHPC container. So very successively now we put all the open HPC tools in it so that it can be used for shipping specific subsets of more and more tools which the community, the open community, collects to ideally in the near future basically into a hub, into a library. So when you say, okay, my code has this requirements, then I could use this subset. Because nobody really wants to use 60 different tools which they just announced, right? So it's a growing set of tools which are coming. So that is that one. We have announced that. So we have interconnected, or we have integrated this with Slurm fully and with Univagrid Engine. So we can schedule containers with the existing resource managers now in therefore much larger environments. So there is support for multiple OS distributions, multiple MPI distributions, and there are, in the meantime, dozens of ISV codes. I've already mentioned ANSYS, CDLabco, COMSOL, NoMaker, OpenFOAM, you name it. And complex workflows with Tread Bicycle. We had a wonderful example that CDLabco's Star CCM Plus fluid flow code is spawned off to 8 nodes on Azure. And then there is a small master node where you have DCV for the graphics and for the data. And then you have also like, there is, okay, it's all about InfiniBand, certainly RDMA and MPI. And then on the master node, you have additionally heats from Red Cedar. This is an optimization software. So the optimization software is running in loops, and with every loop, there is a new set of parameters spun off to Star CCM, and then there is a preprocessor, there's a post-processor. So these are now very complex workflows, which you can build with containers.
We can wrap up to give Jeff the chance as well.
We will. And I think that's it. So integration, etc. And this should be it. So that was the old demo, and that was my big thank you.
Cool.
Yeah. Thank you.
Questions for Wolfgang while we rewire our setup here?
My email address is wolfgang.gensch@uberclub.com.